extremely simply, the climate is changing now and rapidly because people, me, you, governments, companies are pumping carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, most commonly by burning fossil fuels. This is already having a big impact, rising global temperatures and sea level, worsening storms, and changes in rainfall patterns. The solution? Humans putting less carbon dioxide into the atmosphere by not using fossil fuels. It's like painfully simple, but way easier said than done. How do we go from a world where everything from our clothes, to our cars, to our food all run on fossil fuels, to a world with zero carbon dioxide emissions? That's a daunting question, and from where I'm sitting, decarbonizing pretty much everything feels impossible. But I also know we have to do it, and we have to start somewhere. Most experts agree to significantly reduce our emissions, we need to electrify basically everything and simultaneously clean up how we produce electricity. So how do we do that? Fortunately, there is a lot of research looking at just that question. Take this massive roadmap article out of Stanford. Okay, I didn't actually print out the whole thing. It's like 200 pages. I've got the first page. Also, I squished it in my bag a little bit, sorry. But lucky for you, Raya Salter, an environmental lawyer, is back here to explain all those pages that I didn't print out to us.
The study looks at whether or not it is economically and technologically possible, using tech that we have right now, to transition 139 countries to 100% wind, water, and solar power in all energy sectors by 2050. And it determines that it is. The researchers assume that by 2050, we will have electrified everything, like gas-powered cars and trucks, and natural gas heating and cooling. This was done by looking at things like census and other population data, including the International Energy Agency's accounting of global energy use. They take all this current data and make projections based on the amount of electricity that we need now, or electricity demand, if you're fancy. Then they estimate how much new clean electricity production will need to meet that demand, and how much ocean and land area will need to do it. The last important chunk of math is how much additional energy storage we're going to need. So energy storage is important because it helps keep the grid stable. But we're going to need a lot more of it in the future because, for example, solar peak production doesn't happen always at the same time when everybody wants to put on their tea kettle. We're not going to go too deep into this, but the report does look at costs and job creation and estimates that we will create more than 24 million jobs than we lose in the deployment of this renewable energy, and also estimates that we may avoid nearly $30 trillion a year in 2050 climate costs.
Before we go any further, let's be super clear on what we're talking about. We're just going to look at a possible end-state energy mix that'll be 100% wind, water, and solar. There's a lot of research out there, links below, that examines if it's technically and economically feasible to transition the whole world to 100% wind, water, and solar. Short answer, it is, but it's really freaking hard. Also, we're not going to talk about nuclear. I made videos about it before, and yeah, there's lots of interesting research out there, but, and I'm going to punt to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change here, nuclear energy could make an increasing contribution to low-carbon energy supply, but a variety of barriers and risks exist. Things like cultural dislike, fear of meltdowns, nuclear is really expensive. These kinds of issues aren't really present in wind, water, and solar as much. And I'm happy to chat about nuclear in the comments, but it isn't part of this video. Cool? Cool. Anyway, this Stanford study looks at 139 countries in total, but what does that mean for one of the largest emitters there is? The United States. What does a possible 100% renewable energy future look like here? Fortunately, there's a handy-dandy map that takes some of the words and data in this massive report and visualizes it, so you can click on the states and see what a potential energy makeup would be. So for starters, it means a ton of onshore wind in the middle of the country. Say hello to a lot of windmills, Kansas, and hella offshore wind here in New York. And obviously it means loads of solar plants in the sunny southeast and southwest. Damn, Vermont, I see you. That's a lot of hydropower. But this map is just a possible future. What does this look like IRL? Are people and governments actually trying to build these kinds of projects? Some states are already aiming for 100% carbon-free energy.
Hawaii has the most solar rooftop PV in the country. Nearly a fifth of all homes in Hawaii have solar panels on their roofs. Hawaii is doing a lot of cool stuff with the grid. They're messing around with a lot of new voltage management tech, like storage and software and inverters, in order to better integrate all this rooftop PV into the grid.
Back here in New York City, where most emissions come from powering buildings, oh hey, another cool map. Gosh, I love maps.
I don't love all your freaking emissions, building.
To deal with all those emissions, New York City is doing broad planning on how buildings of different sizes must share energy data, and how to use energy efficiency and energy conversions, including renewables, to update buildings, lower energy costs, while making the buildings more comfortable and healthier to live in. Over in Colorado, the utility there is planning to retire 2 coal plants while investing $2.5 billion in renewables instead. And wind is definitely going to need to be a big player out there. And in my home state of Maine, our new governor, Janet Mills, has added Maine to the growing number of states with goals of 100% renewable electricity by 2050, and an 80% reduction in emissions in that same time. She's putting together a council to come up with Maine's action plan, which doesn't sound like much compared to the stories from Hawaii and New York and Colorado, but oh my goodness, it's exciting to me if you know anything about Maine politics for the last 8-ish years.
It's important to remember that focusing on reducing carbon emissions alone will not necessarily achieve the best and most effective results for actual people in a way that's fair. While reports like this one that investigate the big questions of what will our future energy mix look like are really great, they don't necessarily tackle the sticky questions of what it actually means to real people to build and maintain this kind of infrastructure. Who will own these assets? Who's gonna pay for them? How will they be sited and regulated? How do we address the ongoing harms of energy systems, like heaping mounds of coal ash near playgrounds in North Carolina, or high rates of asthma in the Bronx, or places where people don't have electricity access at all? There are a zillion things that need to be looked into before we can truly imagine what the physical, economic, and cultural impacts will be from this scenario. But this doesn't mean that we shouldn't try. Reports like this can be complemented with other work that's already in progress. For example, California scientists have developed a mapping tool to identify just where and how different communities are impacted by pollution. California regulators have used this tool and others while working with community groups to develop environmental justice plans and equity frameworks. So I think that this report and others are highlighting a real way forward. Figuring out exactly what our future energy mix needs to look like and should look like is essential if we're going to solve problems like climate change and environmental injustices. The possibilities to reimagine our energy system from every perspective, from economics to health and art and design, are endless.
This video was mostly about a possible 100% renewable future. The infrastructure and cultural frameworks that have to be designed, built, and cultivated are an entirely different story. So we haven't tackled much in terms of economic and political and cultural feasibility, or the specific pathways themselves. If you're interested in something like that, let us know in the comments and we'll work on a follow-up video. But I think it's important to highlight a lot of the good work that's being done by states and cities and individuals to decarbonize our energy grid. It is probably one of the most straightforward ways we can tackle our terrifyingly high emissions. And as someone who always did the easy questions on the test first, so I had more time to deal with the tricky ones, I cannot stress enough how much it is a good idea to stop burning fossil fuels to make power, now, ASAP, so we can move on to even harder problems. Thank you so much for watching. If you want to check out more Raya, check out her Twitter and website, link below, or see the video that we made together a little while ago. And let us know if you have any thoughts or questions about electrifying the world and going 100% renewable would and could and should look like. Bye.